Our opening words are from the Reverend William Schultz. We affirm that every one of us is held in creation's hand, a part of the interdependent cosmic web, and hence, strangers need not be enemies. That no one is saved until we are all saved, where all means the whole of creation. Our unison chalice lighting words are in your order of service right there. Please join me in reading these. Come into this circle of love and justice. Come into this community where all can all dream and believe in those dreams. Come into this holy space where we remember who we are and how we want to live. Come now and let us worship together.
Okay, are there children who would like are willing to come forward for a story? Well, I've got one. Come on up, guys. Well, I guess I'll tell it this way. Gotta have my cheat sheet. All right, have a seat. This is a story. It's titled The Conquerors. The author is David McKee. He's a British author. He also wrote, for some of you who know children's literature, he's the author of Elmer the Elephant. So that may ring bells for some. In this particular story, we start out with a general. And the general rules a country, a very large country. And the people in that country thought that their way of life was the very best way in the whole world. They had a strong army, and they had a cannon. And from time to time, the general would take the army, and he would invade a nearby country. It's for his own good. It's for their own good, he would say, so they can be more like us. Well, the other countries all resisted, but in the end, the general conquered them all. Eventually, he ruled every country in the world except for one. And this was such a tiny country that the general had really thought it wasn't worth his time and effort to conquer that country, but there was no one else left to invade. And so one day, the general took his army and he went to invade the tiny country, the little country. The little country surprised the general. They didn't have an army. They didn't fight back. Instead, they greeted the soldiers politely. "Good morning. Have you had a long journey? Oh, you must be so tired." They treated the soldiers like they were guests. They gave the general the biggest house in the main city to live in, and they bunked the soldiers, one soldier per family, all across the country. The soldiers talked with the people, and they played their games, and they laughed at their jokes, and they listened to their stories. The food was really different than the food they were used to. They watched it being prepared, they tasted it. It was delicious. With nothing else to do, no fighting, no conquering necessary, the soldiers started helping the people in the little country with their day-to-day work. When the general noticed, he was furious. He said, "Oh my goodness, they're treating the people in the little country as if they're us." And he sent all the soldiers home and he brought new ones in. And guess what? The same thing happened again. You got it. And again. And finally, the general said, "I don't think I need an army stationed here. I'm just going to leave a few policemen, and then I'm going to go home." Well, so he did. And the soldiers walked home with him, and he walked into the main capital of his nation, and the soldiers were singing, "We are the conquerors. We are the conquerors." But you know, something was different back home. The cooking smelled like the cooking in the little country. People were playing games that they had learned in the little country. Even the clothes were some of the clothes from the little country. And the general smiled and he thought, ah, the spoils of war. That night, when he tucked his little boy into bed, his little boy asked for a lullaby. And the general thought and thought. And then he sang the only song he knew, a lullaby from the little country. Let's enter a time of contemplation and of quiet. I invite you to take a deep breath, to let your body relax, to let your thoughts drift, to let your heart soften and stretch and open. Breathe and let yourself settle into the quiet and into the words and into the music. Rest in the safe space that we create here together, what my colleague calls the refuge of our Sabbath home. Rest and let yourself be held. Amen and blessed be.
Our first reading this morning is from the World Peace Game and Other Fourth Grade Accomplishments by John Hunter. I'm going to fix it. I'm going to make everything come out right. That was my student Micah, or maybe it was Cheney, or maybe it was Russell, or maybe even Beverly. Over the years, I've seen many students who enter the World Peace Game with a kind of sanguine self-confidence that borders on arrogance. And I never know whether to applaud their good-hearted intentions or dread the inevitable disappointment when their wish to solve all the world's problems by themselves runs up against the reality that it simply cannot be done. Like our planet itself, the game just isn't built that way. Peace is not a puzzle waiting for the right genius to discover the solution, nor is it a complex mechanism waiting for the right genius to discover the solution, nor is it a complex mechanism waiting for the right engineer to figure out how it works. Peace is a delicate ecosystem that requires a kind of organic harmony among all its participants, from the richest nation to the poorest tribe, from the nomadic Kajazians to the deeply religious Nin, from the World Bank to the weather goddess, from the United Nations to the arms dealers. Individuals can make an enormous difference, but the key lesson that must be learned for the game to be won is that the individual is able to contribute most effectively through collaboration. Without the ability to work with a group, an individual reaches a certain natural limit to what he or she can accomplish. Our second reading is from the Supreme Court of the State of New Mexico, August 22, 2013, Elaine Photography versus Vanessa Willick, Justice Boson's concurring opinion. In this case, this is a case in which the Supreme Court of New Mexico ruled that a wedding photographer could not refuse to photograph a lesbian couple's ceremony of union on the basis that doing so was a violation of the photographer's religious beliefs. This case provokes reflection on what this nation is all about, its promise of fairness, liberty, equality of opportunity, and justice. At its heart, this case teaches that at some point in our lives, all of us must compromise, if only a little, to accommodate the contrasting values of others. A multicultural, pluralistic society, one of our nation's strengths demands no less. The photographers are free to think, to say, to believe as they wish. They may even pray to the God of their choice and follow those commandments in their personal lives wherever they lead. The Constitution protects them in that respect and much more. But there is a price that one one that we all have to pay somewhere in our civic lives. In the smaller, more focused world of the marketplace, of commerce, of public accommodation, photographers have to channel their conduct, not their beliefs, so as to leave a space for other Americans who believe something different. That compromise is a part of the glue that holds us together as a nation, the tolerance that lubricates the varied moving parts of us as a people. That sense of respect we owe others, whether or not we believe as they do, illuminates this country, setting it apart from the discord that afflicts much of the rest of the world. In short, I would say, with the utmost respect, it is the price of citizenship. I therefore concur.
Cool mix of stuff this morning, huh? Children's stories about conquerors and readings from the Supreme Court and a book about war games or peace games. How's it all going to come together? Well, this morning, everything is a game. Science searches for rules to the game set by nature. And every other discipline that humans have created seeks either to craft the rules that govern human societies or to understand those rules and their consequences. This being human, this living together on the same planet, is an amazing set of games. This struggle for peace and for freedom and for justice, both in the abstract and in the concrete in particular, is astonishingly complicated. It has both written and unwritten rules. And part of our struggle in all of these games that we inhabit is that we don't all agree on what the game looks like. And we don't all agree on who gets to play. And we certainly don't all agree on what winning looks like. What the games we play look like, how we live them, and what counts as winning all depends on the rules and the goals that we set, that we inherit, that we agree to, that we abide by, or that we choose to change. Now, to be fair, some of the games that we live in are set up so that only one team can win. In those games, winning means that our team, or one team, gets what they've earned, and too bad for the losers. Sometimes there's not much you can do to change that kind of game. Even Isaac and Zoe, who rewrite the rules for every game we encounter, have a difficult time arriving at a win-win solution when they play chess. You know? Fortunately, there are lots of different ways to build a game. And there are lots of different ways to change a game, even when the game is underway. We can renegotiate the rules of our culture the same way our children can reinvent the rules of a board game. And speaking of board games, the first reading this morning came from this book, World Peace and Other Fourth Grade Achievements. In it, John Hunter, who is a very talented teacher, writes about a 30-plus year project that he's been doing with his students. Every year, he asks them to play a game and arrive at world peace. Now, the game is big. It's a 4-foot by 4-foot by 4-foot, 4-level plexiglass tower. The top level of the tower represents outer space. It has satellites and asteroids in it. The next level down represents the sky. It has all these little puffy clouds, and the weather goddess gets to move them around. The layer below is the layer of land and sea, and that looks like most board games that you've looked at. 4 different colored countries, lots of little different army men and tankers and religious shrines and markers for natural resources. And then the very bottom level is the ocean, under the ocean, with a few submarines lurking and being moved from place to place. If you want to see what it looks like, Google TED Talks and World Peace Game. They've got some wonderful visuals of the game itself. Now, one of the things that pertains to our thinking together this morning is the way that Hunter has set up the game over the last 30 years. In order to win, all those various players, the prime ministers and their cabinets, the World Bank, the UN, everybody, must solve 50 interlocking challenges that Hunter has set. Now, these include environmental and political and social and economic challenges, and they're all woven together. And he doesn't know the answer when he gives them to the kids. In addition to that, by the end of the game, the kids have to ensure that every community within the game has more assets at the end than they did at the start. Okay? His fourth graders have never lost the game. It's gotten down to 3 seconds on the clock, but they've never lost the game. Being one community, being a world community, means that everyone has to be better off in order for it to count as a win. In this story from David McKee this morning, The Conqueror, we have another understanding of what it means to win. Who is conquered, after all, if the only lullaby the general knows is a song from the little country he conquered? Are there ways to understand winning differently? So that sometimes, even before we formally change the rules, everybody wins? Much of the battle around marriage equality has been waged using the strategies of the little country. Living faithfully in committed relationships, sharing stories together of love and struggle, sharing music and food and modeling ways of treating one another with a respect that transcends gender roles. Given a choice, many of us from the larger country have declared ourselves allies and hung up our rainbow flags. And the lullabies that we sing are their lullabies too. Quietly, quietly, the game board got changed, and now the rules have to catch up. That's what's happening in the real world. That's what's happening in the Supreme Court. What goes on in the Supreme Court is a very serious game. It's governed by very stringent rules, and it exists, and they exist, in order to determine if the game we call American culture is being played by the rules we agreed on, and whether or not those rules that we agreed on are the right rules now, or whether they need to be changed. I want to suggest this morning that our 7 Unitarian Universalist principles can be read not just as a set of questions for us to reflect upon, but also as the rules of our game, the one called Unitarian Universalism. If you want to play that game, the rules are in the principles and in our covenants. And they clearly cover how we are to act towards one another, but they also offer guidance for how we are to engage the rules of the other games in the larger culture that surrounds us. For instance, we are to honor the inherent worth and dignity of every person, whether they're Unitarian Universalists or not, whether we're at church or in the grocery store. Our rules also shape how we would like other people to play the game with us. And they identify what we see as the goal of this game that we are all playing together. World community. With peace and liberty and justice
for all of us. As we look at this goal, let's begin by acknowledging that it's simplistic to take the storybook general's attitude. Go ahead, invade your neighbors, it's for their own good. They can be just like you and then they'll be better. The idea that a single culture or a single worldview ought to prevail just doesn't work. Like nature, community is messy. All community is messy. And the more creative and diverse that community is, the messier and the more vibrant and the more generative and the more contentious it can sometime become. But messiness, the disagreements, the struggle to sort through who is included and which rules to the game are fair, that's where the richness is. That's where the learning happens. It's true in this congregational community. We don't always agree. And to be fair, we don't always present our multiple different perspectives in the most tactful manner. Since we actively support this notion of every person's worth, and since we strive to value our differences, we really ought to get used to the idea that we're not all always going to agree. It's why consensus isn't our primary mode of decision-making within this tradition. But what we have to remember is that it isn't our differences or our conflicts per se that challenge our ability to live as one community in peace. It's how we navigate the process of resolving those conflicts. So it's not the fact that we have differences, and it's not the fact that we don't always agree, it's how we reconcile and make space for those differing beliefs. Well, we're not alone. Community in the city of Santa Fe is messy. Community in the state of New Mexico is messy, and not a single person in the entire United States has sorted out all of the issues that are involved in marriage equality. I'm very taken, though, by our second reading, the excerpt from the opinion by Judge Boson. I'm particularly taken by his framing of the tensions that always exist in a free and diverse citizenry, and by his framing of the solution. I'm going to read it for you again, because I've read it about 6 times and you only heard it once. This case provokes reflection on what our nation is about, its promise of fairness, liberty, equality of opportunity, and justice. At its heart, this case teaches that at some point in our lives, all of us must compromise, if only a little, to accommodate the contrasting values of others. He's talking about us, my friends. A multicultural, pluralistic society, which is one of our nation's and one of our congregation's strengths, demands no less. We are free to think, to say, and to believe as we wish. We may pray to the God of our choice and follow the commandments in our own personal lives wherever they might lead us. And the Constitution will protect us all in that respect and in much more. But there's a price, one that we must pay in our civic life. But for Unitarian Universalists, I would suggest that we pay it in our spiritual and religious lives as well. We must channel our conduct, not our beliefs, our conduct, so as to leave space for others who believe something different. Make a space for someone who believes something different. That compromise, he continues, is part of the glue that holds us together as a nation, and I would say for us as a congregation. The tolerance that lubricates the varied moving parts of who we are as a people. that sense of respect that we owe others, whether or not we believe as they do, illuminates this country, illuminates our faith tradition, and sets us apart from the discord that afflicts much of the rest of the world. And that respect is the price of citizenship. Now, these are the emerging rules for our American game, and they're actually very old rules. They're the new framing of the intentions that the founders tried to put into our Constitution and into the rules that they crafted for this emerging nation. And they are very close to the rules for our Unitarian Universalist game because they came from the same people. Now, from my, well, not all of them, but a lot of them. We've got a laugh over there. Now, from my admittedly liberal perspective, granting adults the right to marry as they choose, regardless of their genders, seems to me to be a win-win kind of a game, which expands the scope of human rights and civil protections for GLBTQ people and for their families. And I can't find a single place where honoring their worth and dignity in our actions decreases or diminishes the inherent worth and dignity of anybody else. Formally welcoming GLBTQ people into the marriage game, along with heterosexual people, with all the privilege and structures and consequences that that game entails, expands the number of full participants in our community without excluding anyone who is already in the game. And I think that that's a good thing. But it's tremendously helpful to be reminded that the rules of our American game protect the space for religious traditions to have their own sets of rules and practices. They're little games that happen inside of the bigger game. No faith community should be asked to change its core beliefs. Boy, that's hard sometimes. You look out there and you know it would be so much better if we just invaded, then they could be more like us, right? But that's not the way we play the game. Somehow, we have to govern our conduct so as to honor the freedoms of others and to invite them into the larger game where they honor our freedoms as well. A fair and free world must allow space for great diversity, and it does this in part by providing clear, respectful, mutually agreeable ways of challenging, clarifying, and changing the rules while the game is in play. The goal isn't a single set of rules that stays immutable, but rather a set of rules that can evolve. It's not that any singular expression of values ought to colonize the planet, but rather that we find a way to recognize ourselves as participants in a greater game, knowing that all of us benefit when we respect one another and supporting that delicate ecosystem of peace as it tries to emerge. Just as we benefit as a nation when we bracket our individual differences in belief in order to act for the common good, we benefit as a congregation or as members of a neighborhood when we bracket our idiosyncrasies and govern our actions to support the group as a whole. For a fair, free world, we have to be free to disagree. And at the same time, we have to have the space so that each person, can pursue his or her own happiness to the utmost of their ability. We only win if all of us win. May it be so.
And our light is still burning. Yay! Let us take the light from this chalice flame, and as we extinguish the flame, let us take that light, the light of truth, and the warmth of this community, and the fires of our commitment to that vision of a better world, and let us carry those things in our hearts until we are with one another again. If you would clasp hands and repeat after me, I'm going to lead you through the words of our closing blessing. And I'm doing that in hopes that when you have need of a blessing in your lives, you will have the words to be able to offer one. Okay? Love and skill be in our hands.
Love and skill be in our hands.
Love and courage fill our hearts.
Love and courage fill our hearts.
Love and wisdom light our minds.
Love and wisdom light our minds.
Love flow through us and walk among us.
Love flow through us and walk among us.
This day and every day.
This day and every day.
As we go about the work of living our lives.
As we go about the work of living our lives.
And helping to heal our world.
And helping to heal our world.
May it be so.
May it be so.
Turn now and greet your neighbors.